Let me show you something wild. This iPhone, my iPhone, might actually help regrow a forest in Brazil. And no, I'm not kidding. Apple has set a deadline for itself. By 2030, it wants to be completely carbon neutral. Every product, every factory, every last shipment. Part of that plan involves pouring hundreds of millions of dollars into forests halfway across the planet. But how does planting trees help Apple slash its carbon footprint? And is it really anything more than a flashy marketing ploy? Today, I'm taking you with me on a trip I took to Brazil, into the Atlantic forest, to learn about Apple's ambitious Restore Fund and to hear a conversation I had with Lisa Jackson, Apple's VP of Environment, to find out if the phone in your pocket can really save a forest 5,000 miles away.
The environment is one of Apple's core values, right? And so if you look at the environment, we've set three main areas where we work. And the first is addressing climate change. And we purposely don't say, just remove our carbon footprint. We say address climate change. So we try to do it in a way where we can be an example to others in the private sector where we are.
The Restore Fund is more than just a green initiative. It's a breakthrough in blending corporate responsibility with tangible on-the-ground results. In Brazil's Atlantic Forest, a region once devastated by centuries of deforestation, Apple is partnering with local experts to restore biodiversity and measure carbon sequestration with advanced technology. But how does a tech giant balance economic incentives with ecological priorities? Can a company-led initiative like the Restore Fund address the scale of the climate crisis? And what does a forest in Brazil have to do with the phone in your pocket anyway? It all starts with Apple's 2030 initiative. It's a blueprint for aligning a global company's entire supply chain and product lifecycle with the planet's needs. The goal is carbon neutrality by 2030, and it extends beyond Apple's direct emissions to encompass everything from material sourcing to the energy used when you charge your device.
We've committed to run our entire company on renewable energy since 2018. And of course, with Apple 2030, we're taking it a step further. We want to have zero carbon neutral impact on climate by the year 2030. We have to look at our supply chain and we have to look at their carbon footprint.
Through its scale and influence, Apple prods suppliers worldwide to match its environmental standards. The company has already cut its carbon footprint by 55% with a target of 75%. But the final 25%, often the hardest to eliminate, requires some new approaches.
We're already reduced at 55%. So we have another 20% to go. And that's the work we're doing in partnership with our suppliers. We're done, we need them to do it. But the Restore Fund is to help address that last 25% to get us time between now and when the next set of technologies is ready for coming to market.
In addition, Apple invests in renewable energy on behalf of its customers so that even the electricity used to power iPhones or Macs is offset. This underscores Apple's view that the relationship with a product doesn't end when you take it home. It continues throughout its entire lifespan. Next, let's talk about the Restore Fund. Launched in 2021, Apple's Restore Fund started at $200 million and has grown beyond $400 million, targeting the last portion of Apple's emissions while still offering a financial return. And the idea is simple, yet ambitious. Use nature-based solutions to remove carbon from the atmosphere and do so in a financially stable way.
The Restore Fund is actually just a carbon removal technology dressed in the costume of nature. It's removing carbon from the air to cover that last 25% of our carbon footprint and doing it in a way that's friendly for business, meaning it's an investment. It's an investment that pays back the money invested, but also offers a return, two types of return, a return in money, an economic return, but also carbon has to be removed.
Now, skepticism around carbon credits has long dogged corporate sustainability efforts. Many question whether these projects truly deliver on their climate promises. Apple addresses this by setting rigorous standards for how carbon is monitored, verified, and reported working with partners like Conservation International.
One of the things that we believe we can do is to help raise the bar, set a very high standard for monitoring these projects, carbon removal projects, monitoring offsets, quantifying them, reporting on them, being transparent on them. And the Symbiosis project is a great example of that here in Brazil.
Once spanning much of Brazil's eastern coast, the Atlantic forest has lost over 80% of its original expanse. Centuries of unsustainable logging, agriculture, and urbanization left many areas simply depleted. Yet here, near the coastal town of Trancoso in Bahia, Apple is working with a forest management and investment company called Symbiosis to revive this treasured rainforest. Symbiosis began collecting and planting seeds from what they call mother trees, the most resilient specimens that survived rampant deforestation. Founder and CEO Bruno Mariani started with the highest quality genetic material from a vast native reserve, believing that strong seed genetics would attract diverse fauna and insects to repopulate the forest. Mariani has described his inspiration as rooted in seeing how nature can rebound with the right care. Plant nursery manager Mike Almelo echoes that philosophy, referring to the mother tree as the source of all restoration energy. For him, each seedling produced from those mother trees has the potential to grow into a robust, biodiverse forest that supports wildlife, local communities, and long-term carbon capture. In 2024 alone, Symbiosis planted over 1 million seedlings across 1,000 hectares, which was an ambitious target designed to create what's known as continuous cover forest, one that remains fully forested and productive without resorting to the exploitative logging practices that have long plagued this region for centuries. Symbiosis isn't just about planting trees, though. It's also about ensuring sustainable timber production that preserves biodiversity. Alan Batista, the company's CFO, points out that continuous cover forestry stores carbon both in woody biomass and in the soil, creating an enduring carbon sink. When managed carefully, selectively harvested wood can be regrown continuously, supporting local economies without sacrificing the forest's long-term health.
Well, we're encouraging economic incentives because that makes the project much more likely to survive over the long term. People work there, people have jobs there, and the material and timber that's produced, if it's done in a way that's sustainable, you know, when that's done, wood is a renewable resource. It can be regrown, and in doing so, it actually has a huge positive impact on our atmosphere and on climate change.
Now, one of the most striking features of the Atlantic Forest Project is the use of the iPhone's LIDAR scanner and satellite imagery to measure carbon capture. Symbiosis uses data from partners like Space Intelligence to map land use and track forest growth, integrating it with precise LIDAR scans taken in the field.
The measurement of how much carbon is being stored in any tree at any time can be very time consuming and is based on estimates that can be somewhat imprecise. So we can use technology like the LIDAR in our iPhones to be able to much more precisely measure the circumference and the height and the area of a tree's trunk, for instance, and really cut down on how much guesswork or estimation is involved in the process.
This technology-driven approach helps Apple ensure every ton of carbon counted is real and verified. By standardizing these practices, Apple hopes to bring transparency and credibility to an area of climate action that's often accused of fuzzy math and vague claims. Now, some observers wonder if projects like Symbiosis are enough to move the needle on global deforestation and climate change. And Lisa acknowledges these concerns.
All the technologies that we need will not be ready. So first we have to reduce as much as possible our carbon footprint, but the Restore Fund is to help address that last 25%.
By combining rigorous scientific oversight with local partnerships, Apple aims to prove that nature-based solutions can work at scale. The hope is that other corporations, governments, and investors will replicate this model elsewhere, amplifying its impact far beyond Apple's supply chain. If the Restore Fund demonstrates strong returns, both financially and ecologically, it could spark a new wave of corporate-led restoration initiatives. But the question remains, will Apple's example be enough to convince other industry giants to step up? Now, for Lisa Jackson, this work is more than just a professional milestone. Growing up in New Orleans, she experienced firsthand the consequences of polluted air and unsafe water, an upbringing that shaped her belief in environmental stewardship.
I grew up in a city, and the first time I really became aware of the environment was the negative impacts when the air isn't clean or the water isn't safe to drink, or land has been polluted, all of which was not uncommon. In the industrial areas outside of New Orleans and impacted our air in New Orleans and impacted our water quality. And so I just believe so strongly, originally I wanted to be a doctor because when you're great at science and math, your doctor is sort of your first scientist that you know really well, and mine was a woman. And I thought I want to be just like her. But as I moved through my career, by the time I got to college, I really came to believe that the most important thing I could do as an engineer was to ensure that the projects that we work on, that I worked on, actually were good for people's health as well, which means preserving and taking care of the environment.
Today, that personal passion fuels Apple's lofty goals. Instead of focusing solely on minimizing harm, Apple is leaning into actively restoring ecosystems and partnering with communities to make it happen. So, that's the story. A $200 million bet on forests, a 2030 deadline looming, and the idea that the devices we use every day could actually heal the planet. It sounds idealistic, maybe even impossible, but Apple's Restore Fund in Brazil is trying to prove that reforestation, local communities, and cutting-edge tech can work together to capture carbon and reshape how we think about supply chains. If Apple really hits carbon neutrality by 2030, it won't just change the phone in your hand. It could be a blueprint for how global companies pivot from pollution to regeneration. So the next time you swipe through Instagram or charge up your battery, remember, there's a rainforest out there growing alongside these products we hold so dear. And that, in a world full of climate doom scrolling, might just be the spark of optimism we all need. Oh, and since I was talking to her anyway, you know I had to ask Lisa if she was actually standing on the roof of Apple Park during that infamous keynote, or if that was some of Apple's Hollywood magic.
Oh no, it's real. Just like all the work we're doing on climate change is real. I was up on the roof, it was amazing, and sort of a once in a lifetime.